I do appreciate the opportunity to be here. I always do. It is always a highlight of my year to be able to come and to renew old acquaintances, to see good friends, those who we work with and labor with in the Lord. Appreciate the congregation here, the elders, preachers, and all of those who help in all the various ways. When one obeys the gospel of Jesus Christ, as was pointed out by Brother Moses, he comes into a fellowship that he has with God and that he has with others who are faithful Christians. However, if an individual who is a Christian becomes immoral or begins to walk disorderly, does not abide in the doctrine of Christ, becomes factious or causes divisions, begins teaching damnable doctrines, refuses to repent of personal offenses when brethren have gone to him, then those individuals forfeit their fellowship with God. And the Lord's church has the obligation to withdraw their fellowship from that individual. But what about congregations? Obviously, and I'm not going to go through all of the passages that I referred to in the need to withdraw fellowship from individuals, but what about a congregation that starts that? We need to understand in relationship to Bible authority that the Bible authorizes by direct statements, by examples, and by implication. And God only needs one of those three ways in which to authorize something. The Bible explicitly states for a congregation to withdraw its fellowship from an individual who enters into those types of sins that we just enumerated. However, the Bible does not explicitly state for a congregation to withdraw fellowship from another congregation. But the Bible does teach implicitly that one congregation may and must withdraw fellowship from a sister congregation when the need arises. Brother Moses, in his lesson, and I won't go over the points that he made, but established the fact that a congregation can extend fellowship to a sister congregation. If that fellowship can be extended, why can it not be withdrawn from? I started to say extended, but I don't know if that's actually a word, but it would have expressed the idea properly, wouldn't it? Because you are taking back that extension that you have given. If fellowship can be extended based upon common acts, common loyalty to God's word, then when that common acts and common loyalty to God's word ceases, then sister congregations must withdraw their fellowship from a sister congregation. Let's notice in introducing this, a couple or some scenarios. You have two congregations in the same general location. We will call one Congregation A and the other Congregation X. Both congregations are faithful to the Lord, both doing the Lord's work, being faithful in all that that means in their relationship with God. These two congregations, A and X, have fellowship with each other in various works that they are engaged in. And everyone in the area knows that they have worked together. But Congregation X over here slowly begins to change. They bring in a new preacher, let's say, who does not respect the authority of the Scriptures. They start bringing in innovations that are not authorized by God's Word. And finally, they get to the point where they engage in a long period of study and they are supposedly guided by the Holy Spirit to bring an instrument of music into the worship service. And I say it that way because that's why, the way in which they claim. Other innovations are added to the point where there's real no similarity as to what you read in the Scriptures and this Congregation X. Yet, this Congregation X keeps the sign on the building, Church of Christ. Congregation A over here, though, they start seeing these changes and these innovations, and they discuss it among themselves. They certainly recognize those changes that have been brought in by Congregation X have no authority from God's Word. Congregation X is no longer being faithful to God. But then someone in the Congregation A convinces the brethren there that one congregation cannot withdraw fellowship from another congregation. And generally, that convincing comes from that idea that Brother Moses mentioned of congregational autonomy. We would violate their autonomy if we withdrew our fellowship from them, so we can't do it. Now, everyone in the area has known about that fellowship, that common working together that Congregation A and Congregation X has been involved in. They've now seen Congregation X over here doing all of these things that are unscriptural. What do they think about Congregation A now? Well, they have fellowship with one another. They're both churches of Christ. Congregation A must accept and do these things that Congregation A must be doing exactly the same thing that Congregation X is doing. The cause of truth is hindered, and the cause of Satan has been promoted. Because someone convinced brethren that they could not withdraw fellowship from a sister congregation. The latter part of the 19th century, here in the United States, the type of situation that I have just described took place all over the nation. Congregations began worshiping in an unauthorized manner by bringing in mechanical instruments of music. They began perverting the organization of the church, the work of the church. If congregations cannot withdraw from a sister congregation, then brethren, we need to go back and apologize to the independent Christian denomination and the Disciples of Christ denomination. and start having fellowship once again. That's the implication of this idea that one congregation cannot withdraw from another congregation. But let's go back a little bit further. In the first century, the Lord's church was established. But as time went on, the church went into a general apostasy. During that apostasy, should those congregations that remain faithful to the Lord continue to fellowship those who have apostatized? And since that apostasy ended in the Roman Catholic Church, should we go back and extend fellowship to and apologize to the Roman Catholic Church and start extending fellowship to them? If not, why not? We are faced thus with some questions. Is withdrawing fellowship limited only to individuals? Is this action limited only to a congregation's actions toward its own members? And can the passages that apply to an individual who is no longer a part of a particular congregation? If another member over here, let's just say, in congregation 2, was causing division in congregation A, they are not a member of the congregation A, they are a member of congregation 2. Could the Bible passages demanding us to withdraw fellowship from those who cause divisions, it doesn't apply to them because they're not a member of our congregation? If it can be applied to one causing division within the congregation, why could it not be applied to someone who is not a member of our congregation? Again, let's imagine here's congregation T, we'll call it. Several members of congregation T become involved in sin. Doesn't matter what sin right now, but they become involved in sin. And congregation T, thus, is to withdraw fellowship from those members. But what if those members got together real quick and they run over and they began congregation M? Would congregation T still have the right, yea, the obligation to withdraw fellowship from those individuals? Would congregation T have the right to withdraw fellowship from the congregation M? Now, some would say, oh, they wouldn't even have the right to withdraw from the individuals that make up Congregation M because they're part of another congregation now. Well, let's look at some Bible verses. And since Brother Moses read most of these, I'll refer to his reading of them, and I'm going to talk about them a little bit more. He mentioned Acts the 9th chapter in verse 26 here, Saul coming to Jerusalem. He tries to join himself with the church at Jerusalem. And as Brother Moses mentioned, we would call that placing membership. And sometimes we hear the question, do we have the right and should individuals place membership with the congregation? Well, absolutely. Saul did it. He was attempting to here, but the brethren in Jerusalem obviously initially refused to accept Saul into their fellowship. We know the story that here's Barnabas. He comes and he vouched for Saul, and as a result, the church there at Jerusalem accepted Saul. neither Barnabas nor Saul, as far as any record that we have, ever censured the church at Jerusalem for their refusal to extend fellowship to Saul. Can't find it. And so we start learning that a congregation does have the right to question one who seeks to place membership within that with the congregation. And brethren, we need to do a lot more of it, especially now in the Lord's church, as we see the things that are happening in the Lord's church today. Amen. Saul had been a member at the congregation in Damascus. He leaves there, and now then he's come to Jerusalem, and the church at Jerusalem refuses to accept him into their fellowship. One congregation now is refusing to extend fellowship to a member of a sister congregation. If it can refuse to extend fellowship to one individual in a sister congregation, then it can the whole congregation. If not, why not? In Romans 16, verse 17 and verse 18, Paul teaches that we are to mark, and the word mark literally means to look at, to behold, to watch, to contemplate. And may I just very briefly mention, you cannot look at, behold, watch, contemplate without saying who they are. I mean, it's an impossibility. Watch somebody someplace, sometime, somewhere, somehow. Now, that really tells you a whole lot, doesn't it? It's going to protect you a whole lot. But you say, watch this person right here. Now then you start having some information, don't you? It's fixing one's eyes upon, directing their attention to that individual. To avoid means to turn away from them. Carries the idea of withdrawing fellowship from them. Those who would cause divisions, those who cause ones to stand apart, to divide. And offenses, the word offenses originally meant the movable stick of a trigger or of a trap. You'd put the bait on the trap, and that when the animal would move that trap or that to get the food, he moved the trigger and he was caught. Then it came to mean the trap itself. It applies itself to any impediment which would cause one to stumble or to fall. And someone places something before you that would cause you to fall, to stumble, to sin. Then what? You mark that individual and avoid them. But let's notice some applications of this. Should the church at Rome only mark and avoid those who taught false doctrine that caused divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine only to the members of Rome and no one else? If a false teacher comes from another congregation, would the church at Rome have to extend fellowship to that false teacher because this is limited to the church and there at Rome and its own members? What if several false teachers formed a congregation? Would the Roman church have the right to mark and avoid? That's withdraw fellowship from that congregation then of false teachers, of a congregation that is causing divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine? If they have the obligation, as Paul gives them here, an obligation to mark and avoid one false teacher who might be in another congregation or another location, then it would also have the same obligation if it was a congregation of false teachers. And thus you have one congregation withdrawing fellowship from another congregation. In 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, in verses 20 and 21, Paul talks about, here's the church at Corinth, and it is not to have fellowship with demons. Now that seems rather obvious, we would think. Because if you have fellowship with demons, then you do not have fellowship with God. He's saying God and demons are incompatible with each other. But question, what if you have a congregation of demons? Do you have to extend fellowship to them because it's a congregation? But if it's one demon, you can refuse to fellowship? Now, it becomes silly, really, in trying to respond to what these brethren are now teaching, that one congregation cannot withdraw from another congregation. You would be saying that the church at Corinth cannot fellowship one demon, but they could if it's a congregation of demons. How ludicrous. But some might say, well, demons were never in fellowship with God, so you can't withdraw fellowship from them. What if they had been at one time? They had been the church of God at Corinth. But then as time went on, they became the church, or the Corinthian church of demons. Now then, you've got to continue in your fellowship with the Corinthian church of demons, because one church cannot withdraw fellowship from a congregation of demons. Who can believe it? In 2 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, verses 14 through verse 18, Brother Moses read this and dealt with it, but Christians are not to be unequally yoked with unbelievers. And the questions that Paul then goes through show that God is not in fellowship with those things of Satan. Now then, how could this apply to individual Christians, but not an entire congregation? Again, go back to the congregation, the Corinthian church of demons. We're not to have fellowship with one. How could it not be the case that these things that Paul mentions here in 2 Corinthians 6 no longer apply, since it's a congregation? If individuals must withdraw their fellowship, then certainly the congregation would have to be required to withdraw its fellowship from any sinful alliance, whether it be an individual or whether it be a congregation. In Ephesians, the 5th chapter, in verse 11, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. It's wrong for individual Christians to fellowship the works of darkness. If it is wrong for an individual Christian, then it would be wrong for a congregation to fellowship the works of darkness. And the book of Ephesians was written to the church at Ephesus, not just one single individual. But if a Christian cannot fellowship darkness and remain in fellowship with God, by what reason Can anyone imagine that an entire congregation can have fellowship with darkness and remain in fellowship with God? They can't. It's an impossibility. Once a congregation apostatizes, then other congregations, in order to remain in fellowship with God, cannot continue to fellowship that apostate congregation. If they continue to fellowship that apostate congregation, they no longer have fellowship with God. And it being a congregation does not void the obligation that God has given to Christians or congregations to have no fellowship with them, but to expose them, to rebuke them, reprove them, show that they're wrong. Let everyone know they are in error. In 1 John 1, verses 3 through 8, again, this is no doubt in discussing individual Christians. To have fellowship with God, an individual must walk in the light as God is in the light. If an individual stops walking in the light, then that fellowship with God ceases. It no longer exists because he's now walking in darkness instead of walking in light. In reality, he now has fellowship with Satan instead of with God. And God cannot, and be true to himself, continue to have fellowship with one who is walking in sin. Now, why would we, though, imagine that this would be limited to individuals but would not include a congregation of individuals? What if a congregation is walking in the light? Does it have fellowship with God? Well, we see in Revelation and the congregations there that some of them did, didn't they? Why? Because they were walking in the light. It has fellowship with God. And it would have fellowship with all others that are in fellowship with God, even as an individual would. But when a congregation stops walking in the light, that congregation is now in darkness and walking in darkness. God no longer has fellowship with that congregation. Just look at, again, the churches of Revelation that we will be studying this weekend. And if God refuses to fellowship a congregation, then other congregations, in order to be faithful to God, in order to remain in fellowship with God, must withdraw their fellowship from that apostate congregation. And if they fail to withdraw their fellowship with that apostate congregation, then they cease to have fellowship with God themselves. In 2 John, verses 7 through verse 11, John tells us that many deceivers are entered into the world. Deceivers, very simply, are those individuals who would lead people astray. Someone who corrupts the truth of God's word. John mentions one type of deceiver then, that is, someone who denies that Jesus has come in the flesh. These deceivers are antichrist, he says. They are opposed to Christ. We must have, at all times, a watchful and vigilant eye against false teachers of any type. Any deceiver that enters into the world. Why? Because they will lead us astray and destroy our Christian service. Study the entire book of 2 John. It will, if we are not watchful and vigilant, eventually cause us to lose our reward in heaven. If we follow those deceivers, Only by remaining faithful to God can we enjoy our home with God in heaven. But now then we come to verse 9 and talk about the doctrine of Christ. And I don't have time this evening, unless you want to give me another hour, hour and a half, to prove that this is dealing with the totality of teaching which comes from Christ. If one abides in that doctrine, that teaching, then he has God. But when one goes beyond that doctrine, he transgresses, then he no longer has fellowship with God. What if a congregation is at one time faithful to God and faithful to the truth? They are remaining, they are abiding within the doctrine of Christ, but then they go beyond that doctrine. They transgress that doctrine. What then? Well, obviously that congregation no longer has fellowship with God. But then, when we look at verse 10 and 11, we are not to receive that one who has gone beyond the doctrine of Christ into our house, neither are we to bid him Godspeed. The idea of Godspeed literally is a greeting. It's basically saying, do not do anything which could be interpreted by other individuals as an endorsement of that teaching or his actions. That's just a summary idea of what Godspeed is here. Now then, just as it is wrong to bid Godspeed to an apostate individual, it would be wrong to extend and bid Godspeed to an apostate congregation. If an individual departs from Christ's teaching, then it is our duty to withdraw our fellowship from him. As long as a congregation abides in the teaching of Christ, other congregations are in fellowship with it. But if a congregation transgresses that doctrine of Christ, then it no longer has fellowship with God, and other congregations, in order to have fellowship with God, must withdraw their fellowship from that individual. If he does not, then he becomes, or they become, a partaker. There's a word fellowship there. A fellowshipper of his evil deeds. We become morally culpable in the evil that that individual or that congregation is involved in. And thus we are separated ourselves from God. Revelation 2 and verse 5, though. Christ tells the church at Ephesus to repent, do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly and remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. Ephesus at this point in time was still in fellowship with God, but sin was in the congregation. They needed to repent of that sin. The idea of a candlestick or a lampstand is a figure to show the presence of God and his fellowship, that God was still in fellowship with them. But if they did not repent, God was going to withdraw his fellowship from them. He's going to remove it. He's going to take away that congregation's light so that it is now in darkness and sin. Now, yes, God was giving them time to repent, but if they didn't, he's going to withdraw his fellowship. Now you have two sister congregations, Smyrna and Philadelphia. There is in those congregations no condemnation that is recorded for us, only commendation. They were praised by God. They were in fellowship with God. Can those in fellowship with God now continue to have fellowship with the church at Ephesus, if the church at Ephesus did not repent? And God says, I'm going to remove your candlestick, but here's the sister congregation, Smyrna and Philadelphia, who are in fellowship with God, who says, oh no, even though God's removed your candlestick, we can't withdraw our fellowship from you. God can, but we can't. Thus, you have a problem, don't you? Let me mention two objections very quickly. Some will say, well, there's no command for one congregation to withdraw fellowship from another congregation. There's no direct statement authorizing such. The Bible authorizes implicitly without ever the need of having a direct statement. This is really an argument that we saw rising from Antiochism in the years past. Unless you have an illustration, an example, then it doesn't work. Well, God can authorize it by more than just that. He does authorize implicitly, and he has done so for us. But then the idea of it violates congregational autonomy. The scriptures do teach that each congregation is autonomous, overseen by elders who pastor the flock among them. They make decision and optional matters regarding the work of the congregation they oversee. They do not have the right to make decisions upon another congregation of God's people. Elders, though, withdrawing from a sister congregation does not violate that sister congregation. There has been no way in which these elders who are being faithful to God are trying to supplant the elders of the sister congregation. They're not trying to oversee the work that that congregation is doing. They're not trying to remove the rights of that sister congregation from making the decisions they so desire. The elders of the congregation are doing what God says to do and protecting their own flock. They're making decisions for their congregation, not for the sister congregation. And in reality, they're doing exactly what Paul told the elders to do in relationship, as we see in talking about their qualifications, Titus 1, verse 9 through 11, that they are to hold fast the faithful word. And then here's these who begin, who are gainsayers, and he says, you stop their mouths. Well, how are you going to do it if it's a sister congregation? You withdraw your fellowship from it. And thus, you're doing exactly what God expects you to do in taking care of the flock of which you are overseers. Thus, this idea of congregational autonomy very simply does not offset what God has implied in the scriptures that one congregation must, it has the obligation to withdraw its fellowship from sister congregations who are no longer walking in the light. To walk in the light, though, one must become a Christian. He must obey the gospel of Jesus Christ through his faith in God, faith that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that he came to this world and died for our sins. He must repent of his sins, turning away from them to turn from sin and from Satan, to have the desire to live for God and to go to heaven. He makes a confession of his faith in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, that I believe, as the Ethiopian did, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And then he's baptized or immersed in water for the forgiveness of his sins. He becomes a Christian, and now then he enters into that blessed fellowship with God and with other faithful Christians. If you have not done that within your life, then we would plead with you to obey that gospel of Jesus Christ this evening. There is nothing greater, nothing more important that you could ever do within your life than to obey the gospel, to come into that fellowship with God. If, though, you have left that fellowship with God and their sin within your life, then God provides another way that if we will repent and pray to him, he is willing and ready to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness so that we can once again enjoy that blessed fellowship with God and with other faithful Christians. So if you've gone astray from the way of Christ this evening, repent of your sins. Let us pray with you for the forgiveness of them. And a loving Heavenly Father stands ready and willing to forgive you of all of those sins and to once again enjoy that fellowship with Him and that blessed hope of an eternity with God in heaven when Christ comes again. If you need to respond to the Lord's invitation, we would encourage you to do that as we stand and sing the invitation song.